On behalf of the family, I would like to thank you for being here and for taking the time to come and celebrate our life. We are not here to say goodbye, but to say see you soon. And that's the hope that we have for all that have trusted Jesus as the Savior. And that's what Norm did, and we know that. And it's a great opportunity for us to celebrate a life where we are. It's not by any means a celebration of a perfect life, because none of us have that, but it's a celebration of a life that was under the direction of the Lord Jesus. And that is the grace that is upon us, and that's why we can celebrate today. So thank you for being here, and thank you for taking the time. I know some of you came from far away, and others just stopped what they were doing to come and celebrate. And it's a great encouragement to be found here. So let's open in a word of prayer, and we will celebrate on this life. Father, we come before you at this time, and we want to dedicate this time as an act of worship. We want to exalt your name. We want to recognize that you are God and there is no other. We want to recognize that Mom's life is a testimony of what you can do in a life, that you can do to transform a sinful person and make it not a perfect person, but to make it your son, your daughter, and transform them by the grace that is given to us through your son, Jesus Christ. We thank you for his life. We thank you for his family. And we ask you that you will receive all the glory and all the honor. And we thank you that he's now enjoying your presence. And that we will continue to be looking forward to do the same and be with you for eternity. We thank you, and we ask you all these things in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Now we're going to read the obituary.
I'd like to welcome you here and appreciate you coming out. You know, it's hard sometimes the weather and COVID and all this, but the thing is that we just appreciate you being here. I want to read the obituary. It's kind of lengthy. It looks like several more pages because my wife put the font pretty good size for me, but I think it's important that we read this and think about it together. And so I'll just start. Norman Panell passed into glory at 5 p.m. Tuesday, October 20th, 2020. He was born on September 24th, 1926, in Lee Creek, Arkansas. Norman's parents were Thomas Lee Panell and, by the way, they pronounced it Panell in the past because they had two N's, so he didn't have a birth certificate. When he went to the Navy, they changed it to one N, and so I'll be pronouncing it Panell as the rest of the way here. And Martha and Ann Bond. His siblings were Beulah, Roy, we called him Lem, but it's Lemuel, it's really his name, and Onita. He joined the Navy on September 9, 1944, and was discharged in 1946. He went to Landing Craft School and received a Victory Medal, American Campaign Medal, and Asiatic Pacific Campaign Medal, and he served on the U.S. SLST 899 and the U.S.S. Samaritan, Ohio. He married J. Ruth Barker on June 17th, 1946. Education, he went to school through the eighth grade and later graduated from Muller Barber College in Yakima, Washington in 1947. He attended Prairie Bible Institute in Three Hills, Alberta, Canada from 1956 to 1964. Jobs, he farmed in Vantage, Washington in the 1950s, barber shops, and he was a contractor at the same time. In 1955, he was in charge and leveled land and put in the Columbia Basin project, the irrigation system there. And there are some people here today that would know about that. In 1959 to 1964, Norman moved his family to Three Hills, Alberta, Canada, to attend Prairie Bible Institute. He had received Jesus Christ as his personal Lord and Savior at the age of 30. He and Ruth decided that he needed Bible education since he had only graduated from the 8th grade and had a GED. So he moved his family to Prairie Bible Institute in Canada. After 5 years in Bible school, Norman felt called to go to Northern Canada to start a missionary ministry with the Canadian Sunday School Mission. He worked with immigrants and pastored a community church. He sponsored 5 immigrant families and that had escaped from Poland, Russia, and Ukraine. In 1966, Norman and Ruth moved their family back to Moses Lake, Washington, where he worked in construction. In 1967, Norman and Ruth moved their family to the Tri-Cities, where he pastored a church as an ordained pastor with the Conservative Baptist denomination. He was the first ordained pastor of the Bethel Baptist Church in Richland and helped build the first church building on Jadwin Avenue. Later, he moved to Aberdeen, Washington, and worked again as a barber and contractor to support his family. He was a volunteer chaplain for the fire department there, and it was at this time that he became interested in raising Charlotte cattle. In 1980, he moved to Granger, Washington, where he raised and showed Charlotte cattle at fairs. He was very active in the Calvary Baptist Church in Toppenish, where he drove a school bus and van to help transport kids to Sunday school for 15 years. In 1994, Norman and his wife Ruth moved to South Natchez Road in Yakima, Washington, so Ruth could be close to a hospital since she had suffered several heart attacks by this time and had a pacemaker. She passed away in 2000. Norman continued living at his home on South Natchez Road until a year before his death. There he had married Alice Pace, who preceded him in death in 2017. Norman moved to Ponderosa Assisted Living Home in Yakima and later to Good Samaritan, where he passed into heaven October 20th, 2020. He always loved raising a garden and fruit trees. He loved working with his and Bonnie's Charlotte cattle. But most of all, he loved seeing the children that came to catch their first fish. So he made 2 ponds where children could come and fish for free. But they would also be given the gospel before they went home. And usually someone from the Westside Church was asked to share the way of salvation with the children. Many received the Lord Jesus through this method of evangelism, which was Norman's greatest love. Since being saved, he wanted only to lead someone else to the Lord, and he did this many times. Norman loved his children, grandchildren, great-grandchildren, and great-great-grandchildren, and is survived by 63 others. Here is a list of those children: Gary, Marlene Panell, Bonnie Farrell, Catherine Terry Thompson, grandchildren Tom Farrell, Christopher, Christine Panell, Michael, Megan, Harold Panell, Sean, Kimberly, Farrell, Aaron, Jessica Thompson, Deborah, Walter, Hessenfaller, Brandon, Heidi Thompson, Stephen and Nicole Livingstone, John and Tony Anderson, and a grand Natasha, Tyler, Saints, Curry, Angelica Lieber, London Farrell, Levi Farrell, Ivan Livingstone, Jenny Livingstone, Francesca Thompson, Alexander Thompson, Madison Thompson, Hazel May Thompson, Elliot Thompson, Alice Rose Thompson, Rowan Thompson, Ambrose Thompson, and Ezra Anderson. And great grandchildren. Elijah Thompson, Devin, Desmond, Dexter, and Dean Jacobson, Natalie, Kylie, Tyson, Addison, Sainsbury, and Delilah Christensen. He was preceded in death by his parents, his spouse, Ruth Panell, and his second spouse, Alice Panell, his sister, Beulah, and his brothers, Roy and Elenio. He was also preceded in death by his grandson, Ryan Thompson, who died in the line of duty as a county sheriff in Kittitas County on March 19, 2019.
Let's remember the grace of God by singing a song, this beautiful hymn that is Amazing Grace.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now am was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear the hour I first believed. When we've been there 10,000 years, bright shining as the sun, we've no less days to sing God's praise than when we first begun.
There is a special that we need to hear, and I would like for us to take the time to think about, as you listen to this beautiful music, think about memories, things that you experienced with Norm, and that you can celebrate his life by thinking about the great experiences that the Lord allowed us to have with him.
Thank you.
Thank you. It's a wonderful way to think about what a life means and how the Lord rescued us with His amazing grace. I remember meeting Norm a long time ago, maybe not as long as you guys know him, but I've been a pastor of Westside Church for 7 years, but I met him way before that, because I've been in Yakima 21 years, and still nobody has asked me to leave. So, if you remember, he will have a very strong handshake, very strong one, and I always love to do that. He always sat at the same place in our lovely area that we call the Commons, and he will have a cup of coffee, and I will always go and say hi to him, and he always has a great attitude. Some days were better than others, especially towards the end, as he was shooting with and all that. But always have that loving smile and that great attitude. And for us, it's a great loss. We will miss him as a church, but it is also a great joy for us, because we know that death is the last step going home for the believer. Mm-hmm. It's just that last step that you take going home. And in 2008, we encourage people in our church to plan for their funeral. It's not that we're wishing that people die, but what we would like is for them to be ready for that in any situation. So in 2008, Norm put together his funeral, and one of the things that we ask is, what are the songs that you would like? What are the passages of the Bible that you enjoy and that impacted your life? And anything else that they want to be included in their funeral. And if I was reading Norm's one, we put it out on the records, and it was very interesting, because he only say, whatever songs you have to work, whoever does it is okay. I just honor that somebody would like to do that. But at the end, he said, there is a passage in the Bible that changed my life. And I really think that it's a great opportunity for us to listen to that passage and to meditate for a moment and how that life was transformed by that passage and how it might transform yours. And what he wrote down in 2008 was Luke 11, verses 9 to 11. But I would like to share with us all the way to verse 13. This is the passage in Luke 11, 9 to 13. So I say to you, ask and it will be given to you. Seek and you will find. Knock and the door will be opened to you. For everyone who asks, receives. The one who seeks finds, and the one who knocks, the door will be opened. Which of you fathers, if your son asks for a fish, will give him a snake instead? Or if he asks for an egg, will give him a scorpion? If you then, though you are evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your Father in heaven give the Holy Spirit to those who ask him? And I would like to say three things about Norm's life that I believe was what impacted him through this passage. In his testimony, he said that it was when this passage was read by him, because his brother Roy took him to the pastor, because he was seeking the Lord, he was impacted by the grace of God, but he didn't know what to do and how to do it, and it seems like his brother Roy was kind of getting frustrated with him. And then he said, well, let's take you to the pastor, so the pastor will take care of you. You know, and when he went to the pastor with his brother Roy, he read this passage to him. And Norm said, that's it. That transformed my life. That I know that God did good things to his people. I think that the first thing that we need to think about is that when we understand God's plan, we will experience a life that was, in the case of Norm, woken up by asking, seeking, in nothing. There is a life that will, that was woken up, that he was, like as we just sang in the song, he was blind and now all of a sudden he could see by seeking, by asking, by knocking. He was looking for something to fill that void in everybody's life that so many times we try to fill that with so many things. Because we are asking, we are knocking, we are seeking. But oftentimes we're looking, knocking, and asking in the wrong place. And this is what woke him up. See, now I found the place where I can receive what I'm asking for. That I will receive what I was seeking, and the door will be open. Because now I have found not only the way to the door, but I found the door that is Jesus Christ. So when he heard these words and say, he asked and it will be given to you, and you will seek and you will find, and knock and the door will be open to you, that woke him up. And he transformed his life forever. But not only that, we can see that because of that, because his life was woken up by the power of the Holy Spirit, then now you can see that he experienced a changed life by God's power and grace. Many of you may have seen known Norm before he was a believer. I didn't. But what I can tell you is that I met a transformed man. Changed man. A man that it was not by any means perfect, because none of us are, but he was constantly seeking and looking for the direction and the guidance of the Lord in his life. And because of that, you can see that he will read this passage and he will see that. Say, which of you fathers, if your son asks for a fish, will give him a snake instead? Or if you ask an egg, he will give him a scorpion? That he saw that and he said, we who are evil give good things, how much more the Lord will give us great things. So that really changed his life forever and constantly changed it for the rest of his life. And now his life is perfect because he's with the Lord. Mm-hmm. Not because of his effort, not because of his performance, but because of what Jesus did for each one of us on the cross to pay the price of our sin. He trusted that. He was transformed by that. And he walked his life in that way. And thus, because he understood that we are evil, but in the hands of the Lord, we can be transformed and we can be guided. If you then, verse 13, though you are evil, know you how to give good things to your children, how much more will the Father in heaven give the Holy Spirit to those who ask him? We see that in his life, and I have the privilege to see that. But I think that now he can experience the full vision or perspective of a life that was guided by the Holy Spirit. His involvement, for example, that I didn't know, his involvement in starting Metro Baptist in Richland. Think about for a moment. Right now, Bethel Baptist is the biggest church of the conservative Baptist movement in the state of Washington. There's thousands of people that have heard the Word of God and be transformed by the Word of God by the effort of, among others, that Norm Panell was involved in that. There is thousands of kids that I can tell you that heard the gospel and responded to the gospel just because he had the initiative to put a couple ponds and a bunch of guys from the west side invited kids and took them there, and he was so happy to see that happen. How many children will meet him in heaven and say, because of that pond, because of that fish, I received the Lord and I am now here. He might not know the impact, and we certainly don't know. But I think that now what he was seeing in partial, now he sees completely. And the Lord is rewarding him, not because of his perfect performance, but because of his faithfulness to allow him to guide him. Even in the truth and mistakes, the Lord works in our lives and transforms us so that we can repent, be forgiven, and continue on. And that was the light that I saw in Noah. I will never forget his always words of encouragement to me. He always tells me, Pastor, I'm praying for you, and I always tell him, I need it. And it was always very pleasant to spend time with him. Because you can see a life that was woken up by asking, seeking, and knocking. It was a life that was changed because of the power of God and the grace of God. And it was a life that was guided to give. And to give everything because God has given us everything. Another passage that was very, very important to Gary, I think, that summarizes what I'm talking about in his life and applies to our lives. And it's a passage that we all know, but that we all must keep in mind every day of our lives and apply to our own lives. And it's John 3:16. In John 3:16, we read that, for God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. And that was exactly what Norm understood, and that's exactly what he loved others to understand. And that's the very reason why we are here today. Because we need to understand four things. And they're right there in John 3:16. Number one, you need to know that God loves you. You need to know that it doesn't matter what you have done. It doesn't matter how far you feel that you are from God. He loves you. And he loved you so much that he gave you, and that's the second thing, the best gift that we can ever receive. He gave us his Son. He gave us Jesus Christ to pay the price that we could not ever pay. And Norm truly understood that. So he loved you. And he loved you, demonstrating that by sending the best gift, the Son of God himself was sent so that he can take your place and my place to pay the price that we were not able to pay. Number three, God wants to save us. He wants to save us for giving our sins that Jesus paid for on that cross. Jesus was not a martyr. Jesus went willingly to that cross to take your place in my place. He wasn't killed. He offered himself as a sacrifice so that we will have life because he experienced death. And because of his resurrection, we not only have life, but we have life eternal. And lastly, God wants to give us that eternal life and guide our life also here. He wants to save us. He saved Norm many, many years ago. And it was not because how good he was, not because how faithful he was, but it was because he trusted in the name that is above all names that paid the price for your sin and my sin. So today, I think that the best way that we can honor his life is to consider that. For us that believe in Jesus Christ, we know that we will see him again. And the question for you is, are you going to see him again? But most importantly, are you going to see the Lord again one day? Because we all will. But we want to do it in good terms. And we want to do it as saved people. And we want to do it so that he can receive us. And he can allow us to experience his presence for eternity. Because the last thing we want is to be separated from him forever. This life is short. Even for people like Norm that live for a long, long time. this life is shorter than what we call eternity. So one way that we can honor this life is by considering the reality that God loved you, that he gave you his son as a substitute to pay the price for our sin, and that he wants us to believe in him, save us, and give us eternal life. Today might be that day for you. So if you want to talk to somebody, I'll be here, I'm available. Gary will be here. Pastor Dallas is back there too, and I'm sure he will be available as well. If you want to talk to somebody about that, if the Lord is speaking to you, don't let that pass today. Because it's the opportunity that we have to experience a life that was transformed as Noah's life was transformed. I just want to finish our time and the word by reminding you that God is so good to us that we even receive what we don't deserve. And I can see that in one shot. He was a very grateful man. He knew that everything that he had was the Lord. And even as he was aging and thinking probably oftentimes about the end, he wanted to do everything as possible to let others know that the Lord is good and that his grace is available to all of us. So let's honor him by giving him such a way, and that we can remember that everything that we have is given to us by the Lord, and that we should not be attached to this world, because this world is so temporary that sometimes we look back and we just ask, where did time go? I don't know if it happens to you, but it happens to me all the time. I was supposed to come to Yakima for 6 months. And these have been the longest 6 months of my life. And I look back, and now I have 21 years here. And I'm not getting any younger. And neither do you. And we need to think about eternity more often than what we do. Let me pray. Father, I ask you that we can understand grace more and more. That we can understand that salvation is not something that we earn, but it's something that we receive. That we can understand more and more that it is by grace through faith. It is not of our own effort. And when we see a life like Noah's life, we can celebrate today because of that too. And I ask you that your Holy Spirit will speak to us. And let us know what our needs are at this very moment. And that we can be transformed constantly by that Spirit so that we can follow you and we don't go and ask. We don't go and knock. We don't go and seek to fill the voids in our life in the wrong places. So thank you. And we ask you all this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Now we're going to have a time that people want to participate and share a memory and share a comment. So there is a mic in the back that you can raise your hand and the mic will magically appear to you. We got Gary here.
Thank you, Brother Elias, and we appreciate the word that you shared there, and it's so true. And the last week and a half of my dad's life, I wanted to share just a little bit with you, because as you know, it's really hard being in nursing homes or hospitals right now, and there's not much access, and he felt like he was in jail. But you know, that's the reality of it, and it was very hard for me to be able to get in to visit with him, and you couldn't do that until the end, actually. We were outside, the window was calling in, and he doesn't hear too good on the phone and that sort of thing. But they, my sisters and I were able to, the last week and a half there, we were able to go in one at a time, only three a day. And that's one reason we didn't call a lot of people and say that, you know, he doesn't have much time to live and so on, but it was only a few that could go in each day. But while I was in there this past Monday, actually, and I knew that it seemed like it was getting really, really close. There was a time that he had a stroke and he revived from that, and he was able to talk to us, and he, you know, we did have some time fellowship even a couple weeks ago. But the thing is, then after that, he started going downhill again. And I was sitting there, and my sisters and I, we would go in and spend time with him and read the scripture to him. Then we would sing our play songs on our cell phones, and then also just pray with him. And so let me just read to you what I wrote there, if you don't mind. This was Monday night, October 18th. This is Gary Thomas Panell, and I wrote in the back of his Bible. This is his Bible. And I said, with my dad, Norman Panell, in Good Samaritan in Yakima, Washington, I'm playing for Dad Jim Reeves' hymns as he sings. It is all so bittersweet for me because I know Dad is going soon to heaven. I hate to see him go, but I know it is the best for him. He is going to heaven because he accepted Jesus as his Savior. Not only that, but he and Mom led me to Jesus when I was 9 years old. As I'm sitting here with Dad, watching his eyes so peaceful, looking when he hears his favorite Christian music, the old hymns. Then I read and I read John 3:16 in his King James Bible. Dad has an oxygen mask on and is breathing rather hard, but doing all right. I tried to give him some water, as I had before on many previous visits, but he was choking more on it, so I stopped trying and put his oxygen mask on again. This happened before I played the Jim Reeves hymns and read John 3:16. It was like we were having his church service, which is where I had just come from. Sunday morning, actually. Dad stares around with a kind of distant look in his eyes. I know he must be thinking about heaven, and he must be wondering when Jesus is coming for him. I hope he is glad we are visiting with him. I sang with Jim Reeves to Dad, I would rather have Jesus than to be a king with a vast domain. And then now it is 1:37 p.m. And that was the 18th of Sunday. Songs, Take My Hand, This World Is Not My Home, I'll Fly Away. Then the Tennessee Ernie song, and I was, Dad had my hand, and as that song was playing, and then Rock of Ages, we'll have a new body, I'll have a new life, those songs and so on. But one of the Tennessee Ernie Ford songs, that's a little upbeat, and he took his arm, and he was playing it to the music, to the rhythm. And I knew that he could hear that song, and he was listening and thinking about it. So that's what I wanted to share with you just a little bit.
Tom Hale, and Norm was a friend. Lots of memories with Norm. I was a part of a men's ministry group that was able to minister to really hundreds of kids over the last decade out at the ponds that Norm and Bonnie and Tom so graciously allowed us to use. And the memories are ones of kids. We can all think about how are we when we hear kids out laughing, enjoying life, playing with each other. It's just infectious, and that's a blessing to all of us. And so when we watch the kids perhaps catching the first fish of their life and the joy in their eyes, or perhaps when we encourage them to hold the fish after they were caught and the screams and beaks that went out with that, the wonder of these kids when we would share the gospel with them sitting on bales of hay under the walnut trees on the farm. Special memories, but maybe the greatest memory I have of Norm is his life's testimony. He was a man who lived his belief, and he shared that freely with everybody that he came in contact with. And that was a lesson to me and an inspiration to me. The men that shared his ministry out at the ponds, we put up a sign for Norm a few years back. And just to honor him and to recognize who he was before God. And on that sign, we referred to Psalms 118 that said, "This is the day that the Lord has made. Let's be glad and rejoice in it." And what a verse for everybody that comes out of those ponds to see. So we know, Pastor Elias has said often here, that we can rejoice because of his love of Christ. And his love of people. And yet, amazingly, of bringing those together. That's my memory.
I enjoyed sitting at Norm's table and listening to his stories. He was one of the first people after the bomb was dropped in World War II in Hiroshima to walk through the ashes. And he left the ship without permission, and the captain got really upset about that. And he says, "You were not allowed to go." He says, "We didn't think you'd even make it, because right after you left, a full platoon of Japanese soldiers was marching. You were around the corner. Our men saw you, but we just didn't know what to do. We couldn't call to you. We didn't want to alert them." He said, "Did you see them?" He said, "No, I didn't see them. I just wanted to walk through it." When he came down with cancer, he asked his doctor, he says, "Can I walk through the ashes of Hiroshima? You think that's what caused the cancer?" The doctor laughed. He said, "No, that's quite a few years ago." He had some amazing stories about his friends being tarred and feathered because they were cheating the cars up in Alaska. Just goes on and on. This man was amazing. When he came to Christ, his life spun. What I most remember about him is the faith that he had. And he said to me one day, he said, "I was going through some records and I see that I didn't pay a man for some work done for a furnace." "Oh? Yeah, would you help me find him?" "Sure. Do you have his address?" "No." "Well, where does he live?" "Well, either Centralia or Shahilo. It's just one of those. I'm not sure." He said, "Would you take me over there?" And I said, "Sure." He says, "God will provide. God will show us where he is." And I said, "Okay." So we go over there, and we go to the place where it was, and the house was gone. And he says, "Well," He says, I have an idea. And he went to a place of business and he got a phone book and he looked for the man's name. He wasn't there. He says, I have another idea. And he went to the post office and asked, and started asking about that name, and she wasn't sure. And he says, huh? He says, let's drive around for a while. So we're driving around and we're out in the country. And he says, turn here. So this looks right. He says, no, this isn't right. Let's go back here. And he says, oh, turn here. Well, then he goes to the house and he says, I think this might be someone who I know. So he said, do you remember the people who used to live around here? Their name was such and such. And she goes, well, yes, they moved. And that lady over there is in touch with them and across the street. So we went across the street and they said, yeah, I have their address and phone number right here. Why don't you give them a call? So I'm just astounded. This man's faith was, God will provide for this. We just need to get over there and God will make this happen. And so we went to his house and had a wonderful time there. And he said, well, I'm here because I owe you some money. And the fellow says, what for? He says, for some friend's work. It was then, it was over 30 years ago. And he goes, oh, Norm, I forgot all about that. This one says, well, I have it. And they go, right, you wrote him out a check right there. That's faith. And the understanding that he didn't want to have any debt to any man except that of love. Amazing man. Change my life.
Last chance. Raise your hand. Well, we're going to pray. It will be a graveside, just followed by this service. And on behalf of the family, once again, thank you for coming and supporting them. And also, Rudy family, please be assured that Westside Church and many other churches will be praying for you as you grieve the loss of a loved one that we all will miss, but we're also looking forward to see you again. So,
just mentioned that there's flyers back there. It says, what happened to Shorty? That's a track that he wrote when he got saved in Moses Lake. So it's back there by where they signed in. Anyone can take those.
Okay, there are a little track that Norm wrote when he got saved called What Happened to Shorty. And it's right there by the sign book behind the door. Thank you and we'll pray. Father, we thank you for our life a little bit. And we thank you that we can rest in you. That your love and grace is sufficient. And we ask you that as we remember Lord, we will remember what we are able to do in our life that surrenders to you. We ask you that each one of us will think about what the Lord can do in a life that is open to receive that transforming power of the Holy Spirit by faith in Jesus Christ, and that we can honor and celebrate his life by giving him the greatest joy that I ever saw in his face, is when somebody who trusts him. We thank you and we ask you that you give comfort to the family, and in that we also receive it. And we ask you all that it's in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you, Lord.
I'm going to let you go ahead and dismiss yourselves. Our veterans have called and they're waiting for us.
Okay.
Yeah. So we have the veterans before the will be doing a special tribute there, and they're at Cemetery Wing. All of you that would like to go out, you're certainly welcome. We have a precess court here that will be
gotta hold it. You okay?